And it's at three lines from the bottom. On page I'm off. V'lochein ba'aveda de mechi. In aveda of mechi. Which means, if in the intellect, in mechi, one does avodah, it goes very deeply into the course. And recognizes the greatness and the goodness and the truth of Elokus. Im heyoisoy b'mchines kirov and veikos b'moichon. Despite the fact that he is in a state of closeness, not only of closeness, but veikos of a cleavage, actually interrelationship in his mind with Elokus. Yochel yiyoyis. It's still possible, shahachum yiyoyis, the nefesh habam is, that the coarseness and the lowliness of the nefesh habamis will be mkoima, remains in place, will be tokvoi, not only in place, but in full force. Adayin. After all that experience, remains in the same focus and this and a decisive approach to humnis. And that has not been touched at all. Why? Because the Rasha Bamis has not been reached. It cannot be reached through Moichin, because it exists and it functions on a different level. Only if there is Ahab of a Yiro, love and fear and awe of Elokus, Beizgalus Halev, in full function in the heart, not in the Moya, but in the heart, that one actually feels the awe and the love for Elokus. Poyel chalishut b'nefesh habamis. That can affect the weakness, a weakening in the nefesh habamis, because there it's a direct communication. It is giving nefesh habamis a feel of Elokus. And thereby its coarseness and lowliness is weakened. Because he has been shown and has experienced through the nefesh of Elokus, has been exposed to something infinitely more refined than his coarseness. And thus, he's affected by this. Vegam, and also, bitul hachumri v'amugiz nefesh habamis. It's conceivable that he can reach even further than weakening the nefesh habamis. But actually, bitul, the complete nullification, subjugation of the chumri and the mugiz, the coarseness of the mugiz and the personal and the sensing of the nefesh habamis, Mr. Kosovo Moki Machik, as is explained elsewhere. To truly affect the nefesh habamis, you have to have, in the nefesh habamis, you have to have midas, a connection to Hashem through midas, rather, not only through Moich, which is, in the nefesh habamis itself, it's also a phenomenal transition, phenomenal work. Formation should come in Midas. But it's not a transformational type of thing. It is something which simply reaches out. Nefesh habamis, it is a transformation. Well, okay. And thus, okay, the Rebbe gives us a very simple bottom line. Ein li yistapek ba'aveda the making about. It should not, one should not be satisfied of having avodah of meichi, of just avodah of meichi. Kim, rather, tzorich liyos ho avodah be'abba v'yiro shebelev. There must be also the avodah and abba v'yiro in the heart. Because otherwise, the nefesh habamis is not affected. If the Nefesh HaBamish is not affected, that means that he has not worked the union of Elokus through his entire being. There's a part in him that knows nothing of Elokus, is not interested in Elokus. It is nevertheless true that mitzad ha-gilui, that from the perspective of gilui, of what is recognized, what is expressed, yesh yisrin godol b'meichi, there is a great advantage, superiority in meichin over midas. In the principle of gilui, there is in meichin much more than in midas. Gilui means that the godly presence is in full glory, and that is present in Meichin more than in Midas. We'll discuss it as we finish this couple of lines. The Yoyis and Bebchines Big, for being that the Meichin are of the quality, they have by nature the union of Bitl. Because Moichin are not seeking for personal grasp and personal experience. Moichin seeks to see what there is to be seen. Even though it's beyond it, I cannot really acquire it, that's what he wants to see. That's Moichin. Therefore the need for Bitl. Meir Bahem, and therefore Meir Bahem Gilui Oir. So that in Moichin shines what's called Gilui Oir. Gilui Oir means the expression of the Oir of Elokus rather than the Metzius. Oir means the presence. For example, coming down to our common illustration of these principles, a house is a real structure, and it takes much effort to build it. With design and so forth. And yet, what you have in a house is only the metzius. You do not have the sense of the reality of what this house is about. To the extent, as you pointed out, there could be a house that's only a model home, meant for people to observe what a house could look like, nothing to do with the real function of a house. And therefore, there is not anything of the human being in the house. It's only his smarts and his talent and so forth, but not anything of him in reality. On the other hand, this whole phenomenon of being able to project of what a human being would require to live in. And as on the basis of that, you build a house structure. This projection has a very clear, a very deep recognition of what a human being is. Of the Gili Oyer.
Talking about a house that was never lived in, and you project what it would be like to live in it?
No.
And catch.
The design of the house. On what basis are you designing a house? On knowing what a human being is, and what will make a human being comfortable, and what would compromise. There you have to connect to the essence of the human being. And there, this is an interesting thing. In the design, you do not even consider cost or effort, time of building it. You're just taking the human being and translating it in the house. This is what's called Oyer, the impact of a human being. For shelter purposes, you can give him a cave. But when you talk about a house, you're not talking about a shelter. You're talking about something that represents the respect and awe and honor of a human being. That is a completely different thing. You can't buy that with money. So therefore, in mochin, there is much more the principle of gilui oyer. What means gilui oyer? The oyer of the human being. The oyer. The oyer means the reality, the effect of it. Not his presence, but the impact of the being a human being. That's gilui oyer. That is present in the mochin. Because Moichim has the name from Beetle. Beetle means I'm not interested to define it in my terms. I'm interested to see what it is in terms of the source of what I'm trying to define. Not how it makes sense to me.
And that's insufficient to affect the animal soul at all.
That's right. That's right. Like we said yesterday, a melech if you talk in terms of nefesh habamis, there's a melech. The first question is, what's he doing? What's he doing? What's the purpose? What's the benefit of the melech in the country? How am I benefiting from waiting for him? So, this explains that there are, among the servants of the king, there are different categories. There are those who take care of all his properties and so forth. And then there are an elite group. The elite group, these are the army, the soldiers who stand on the ready to sacrifice their lives to safeguard the king. Just to safeguard the king. They don't, if you sacrifice your life, you don't expect any kind of reward. I am not going to even be benefiting from that, which I'm safeguarding. This is possible only in mochin. Not possible in midas. Because midas means I have a personal experience, personal stake in it.
Huh. The soldier who typically you associate with physicality is an expression of high sechel. Did I catch it? Sorry, go
beetle,
again. Yeah, a beetle which we're associating here with sechel, with mind, yeah?
That's right. But the beetle is, that's why a soldier still has to go through training. The training is, and you, like I said, avodah, you eliminate all personal experiences. And what's left is only the presence of the king.
Okay, the training is to kind of move away from his meters, move out from his yesh to being just for the king, yeah?
Right.
Okay, and we started talking about that and the king because we're looking at how meters...
How there is a new from Gilui Oir as a result of Bito. A meter is the reason. That is only... in mochin.
And that gilui or is not going to be affecting in any way the midos or the nefesh b'hametz.
That's right. Again, we translated the inyan from oir. Oir is more, as we discussed later, oir is more associated with the inyan from rotzen rather than midos. Oir is the reality of the king himself, not his effect, not what he provides for you, not the enrichment of the country, but the very simple statement that there is a country, that there is a nation. This is the Melech.
Yesterday, it's even more than the nation, more than it's the king. It's just even without this, even without the provision of the status of a country.
Yeah.
Even though that itself doesn't even have definition, even on that level.
So that was at the end again. These are two lines that I want to learn over again. Okay, at the end of the top line. Omno. In truth, however, mitzad ha-gilui, from the perspective of gili, from the perspective of the revelation, or what is recognized, how refined is your recognition, and how much of the king do you recognize, of the truth of the king? Yesh yisrin godel b'meich. There is a great, tremendous advantage, superiority in mochin over midas. In terms of the gilui, not of the containing, of receiving the presence of the king, but gilui recognizing the impact of the truth of the king. There is more. There is a greater superiority mochin. The yoisam of pinus beetle, because of the main mochin are in a beetle quality, which means they completely ignore their personal experience. When a person understands something, there is a certain experience in that understanding, and he feels elated of the experience of having understood this. This actually interferes with the mochin. The pure mochin is the understanding itself, not the resultant satisfaction that comes from this understanding. And this pure understanding, meir bahem gilui oir, there is meir, shines through the gilui oir, the full expression of the oir of the truth of the avalakos. Not how a lakus can be understood, but what is a lakus itself? Like we said yesterday. There's a very fundamental difference between understanding something as a projection or understanding something as a reality. In my mind, I can project what a melech should be like or what a lakus is like. The reality itself, the recognizing, the identifying with the truth of a lakus, and I'm understanding it because of its truth, it's a completely different reality. I want to go a step further. Please understand the following. See if we can verbalize this. There is absolutely no way that we can project in terms of its truth, of its usefulness, of its reality, a locus. A locus can only be known by total dedication of them. Fact. Rambam expresses it, it says like this, very simple terms. The first principle is to know that there is a first being. What does a first being mean? We mentioned many times. First being means that there is nothing, no basis for knowing what he is. There's nothing before him. He is not answering any question. First being is not an answer, how come there is a world? First being is a truth in and of itself. And he's there not as a facilitator of a world, as a source of world. To know a first being in that totally self-contained truth, this is mech. This is possible only mech. You immediately relate to it to some kind of a functional effect. And in truth, this kind of truth of the Holocaust is only possible in truth. Because the world doesn't provide for it. Knowing it from that perspective, from this truth perspective, is possible only in mochin, and therefore there is gilui oir. The gilui oir, the oir of such of an oir of a first being that cannot be identified or related to any kind of functional benefit. What is it about? It's not about anything. That is possible only in Meichin. And that's why in Meichin there is Gilui Oir. total connection, total dedication to the essential truth. The Hamidos, on the other hand, the Midos, at the end of the second line. The Yois and Mechines Mi Mitzius, because that they are in the state of Mitzius, Midos, there is an experiential element, a presence. It's not total beetle. It's not getting a lakus from a lakus perspective, but getting a lakus from a midas perspective. Mismaid bahem ha'oir. And thus, the oir in a midas is reduced relative to the oir as it is in moich. It is no longer the oir of a lakus, it is the oir as you, as midas, can relate to it. Shene Meir Bahem Begilui Klal, where in Mido is the oil is not Meir Begilui in an overt manner, Klal, at all to Meir Mechin as it is in Mechin. Nothing comparable to Meir in Mechin. Because in Mido is the oil that is recognized is immediately associated with the effect of its presence. But that's not the oil like he is. Okay. Should we learn the kitzur? It's not a brief kitzur. You might as well learn it. I'm sure there's going to be a very good review. Kitzur.
Can I ask something?
Sure.
It says that in Midas, the oil is not mild than the gili, but there is oil.
Yeah, there is oil, but he said begili klal. There is the oil in a midos is not mere begilui, but you in a midos you're projecting. You know that there is the oil. But there's not the oil begilui kmo klal kmo b'meich. Behine aliday slapshus hoiris bekeli. Behold, as a result of the oiris being mislabish, being imbued in keli, areihem bebchinas ischalkus, the mylomat. Thus, the oiris identify in ischalkus a subdivision of mylomat, higher and lower. The whole phenomenon of oil is being having higher oil and lower oil. That is only due to the fact that the oil is a mislabish in Cain. And again, for those of us who go back, the reason that the oil is a mislabish in Cain is not an inadvertent phenomenon. The reason the oiris are mislavish in Kalim is because the oiris inherently, what's called oiris pimiyim, the oiris inherently are seeking to be effective. And to be effective, they have to be slavish and clean. K K'moy b'kechaz ha-nefesh. As, for example, in kechaz ha-nefesh. Kechaz ha-nefesh is also a very, very phenomenal moshel for dinyan for oyer, because nefesh is beetle completely, it's all akus. And it has koiches. And when it comes down to the koiches, which is the oyeris of the nefesh, it's not the etzem nefesh, it's the oyeris of the nefesh. So there you say, koyach ha-chochmo, shehi ha-skolo, mibkines nekudom of shedes adayin. The koyach ha-chochmo, which represents the ha-skolo, the conceptualization in a nekudo, the conceptualization of a principle, mufshetes, that is totally undefined, without any kind of graspable extremities. That's within Haskalah. Then at that point, Meir bo dakus etzem ha'ir. There in that nekuda, in that chokhma, shines dakus etzem ha'ir, the refinement, the gentleness, so to speak, of etzem ha'ir, of the oil, of the essential oil. Dakos etzem ha'ir means which oil? The oil that is expressed, that comes forth in rotzen. Rotzen, this is the rotzen of the yatz. Chochma is really an absorption, a recognition, and a grasp, an understanding, a knowledge of this rotzen. But being that in chochma it is Nakudum of Shetas. It is Chochmah. Chochmah means that you understand it in a context. But you're not seeking its relationship to the context. You're seeking to see the essential truth. So it's like Nakudum of Shetas. So therefore the Oyer, Etzem Oyer, is shines through in the Chochmah. Where do we, the principle of Rotzoin, which we discussed, which is a totally an elusive thing, we can only project it in Chochmah. There's no way we can grasp what Rotzoin is. And in Chochmah also we cannot understand, but we can only project it. Okay, we're not going to go back to all that we discussed. The bina, on the other hand, which is the level of hasoga, level of grasp, which means it is no longer just knowing the truth itself, but grasping it in my own means. So bina conceals the oil of the chokhmah. And then in parentheses, which we learned about the Nekudas HaTamtzis. The Nekudas HaTamtzis is the ultimate result. There is the significance of the Etzem Oyer. Abel hu b'murgosh. But there the Oyer is b'murgosh, is in a state, is experienced, rather than the truth of the Oyer itself. All right, we'll have to interrupt now. Have a great day.